Before I start, if anybody, there are two more sheets over here, it looks like, and some over there, unless everyone's comfortable. I know standing for a bit can be tiring. Alright, so the first poem that I'm going to read, just before, like Skylar said, I'm Langley. I'm a senior at McKinley. The first poem that I'm going to be reading is one that I read for my school's talent show. It's called Strange Fruit after Billie Holiday and after my grandma Lucille and after my own skin. Southern trees bear strange fruit, blood on the leaves, blood at the root, black body swinging in the southern breeze, that strange fruit hanging from the poplar trees. And on that election night, it comes as no surprise that a white hand reaches out of the darkness for the brown in my throat. I think he must not know a brown thing when he sees one. I think he must not know what it's like to have a body like mine, one that's always warm, radiating heat like the sting of a whip on a bare back or like the barrel of a gun that has already been fired. To have a body that is always pink and soft and ready like he must think a woman's is supposed to be. Mr. President must think nothing of shining white cities except how they are built on brown backs. I mean, brown soil and must be protected by brown walls too, huh? Mr. President must know nothing of brown bodies except that they are wooden door frames that he is always able to walk through. Does he know nothing of history? How can a man who wears a comb over as a permanent hairstyle tell me what to do with my box braids, tell you what to do with your hijab? I cannot call him my leader until I know that he knows what it feels like to be in this body. What it feels like to walk by a police officer at night. What it feels like to have your foreign nationality made into an outcry of rage. What it feels like to have your lack of rich whiteness turned into a reason to hate. And it's an inverted kind of pain to feel like this country is no longer yours. It turns inward and then back upon itself. Why does it feel like he does not want me to believe that I have roots here? But I can't lie. Whenever I think of the inauguration, I fear for all the skin that isn't white in this country. Here's fruit for the crows to pluck, for the rain to gather, for the wind to suck. And I keep having these dreams where there are thousands of brown bodies swinging from the rafters of the White House. Have visions of their red blood spilling down its front steps for the sun to rest, for the trees to drop. Here's a strange. And it always ends the same way. My dream. With the man who says he has all the answers reaching his hand for the inauguration Bible to swear in. And in the black sky, there's a big banner that says we've done it. We've made this country great again. And the whole country kneels beneath it on the pavement, silently praying to their American God for redemption, asking him to forgive them for all that they have done. Thank you. Going to read. It's about being an only child, which I am, and it is just as glorious as everyone says it is until it is not. Can I lower this?
Just push it down. Push it down.
Okay, that was easier than expected. Okay. It's called She Has Rescued Them. There, the girl or brown thing stands alone in the house. the house that her father did not build, that her mother does not live in, the house that smells like coffee or vacations or escape, but for only like a minute or two. The house did not make the girl who she was, did not carve its place into her. The house did not provide her food, instead taught her how to hunt. The place that is just a the house that is just a place to stay, a place to rest and sleep. The house was never a part of her mother. Her mother nursed the baby girl, but not the house, so baby girl grew up strong, house frame still, a little shaky. The house is not a person, so it's not nursed with breast milk. Instead, the house is fed with saliva and hard work. Hard work is medicine to the bathtub's faucets, and saliva is doctor to the kitchen's floorboards. The house is not painted with lead. Instead, the house is painted with blood. Blood across the window panes, blood across the door frames. And whose fault is that? The girl wonders. You have forgotten about the girl? You were distracted by the blood, the paint, the breast milk, but the girl is still here. She stands alone. She stands sagging. Girl sometimes stands dead, dead like the Old Testament. Dead like niggas hanging in trees, dead like Robin Williams or any other person with a clean conscience is. But the house shows up at the funeral, and you are surprised to see it looking as healthy as it does, and you almost ask the house to dance, but you remember what happened last time, and you forget that this is a funeral until the house crawls into the casket. And you remember that the casket is just a metaphor for your body, so quick you run to the bathroom and pull the house out of your throat, dangle it in front of your face, and the house hangs as confused as you are, asks how it got here in the first place. The house has suffocated so many under its cinder block, but still, it is never gone. Its name always etched into a dog tag hanging around the girl's neck. Have you forgotten about the girl? You have forgotten about the girl again. Thank you. So my third poem, it is untitled. And it came about from a conversation I had with a friend about what happens after we die. I took to asking people what they thought happened after we died, and everybody had such unique answers. So this was his. The boy says that he does not believe in heaven, says that when he dies, he wants to be reincarnated as a sunflower or a pineapple tree, something sweet and bright and completely unnecessary. I ask, why not another human? And he says, because he already knows what it's like to live inside of someone else's skin, to have a body that is not his but has his name. And I say, well, if I were reincarnated, I'd want to be reincarnated as air. And like usual, the boy thinks that my idea is stupid. But I say, imagine all the things I could be. All the places I could go, I could turn myself into water and then evaporate into the sky to form a storm cloud. I am not sure if that's how science works, but I could will myself to rain back down on my father, onto the seeds that he has planted. I could be wind flowing through her hair as she's walking down the street holding his hand for the first time. I could be the whistle through the gap in his front teeth the first time he sees her. When he is smiling with his whole body. I could even be a queef, which is not preferable, but at least I'd still be taking up space. Still a part of something. Yes, I would be the air. Be the wind, a gust, and not another body. I would be everything that made you, everything that surrounds you, everything that gives you life. And then I could be gone. Thanks. So these next two poems that I wrote were kind of inspired by this incident I had when I was sitting in my school media center. Twice, there were a group of boys and a group of girls on two separate occasions. They were talking about the same thing. They were talking about growing older and being a teenager and going to college and sex and sexuality. But the way they spoke about the two topics were just so different. And so I feel that as a young woman, there are a lot of things I'm allowed to talk about and a lot of things that I'm not. And here are some poems about those things. And the first one is called, the title is pretty lengthy, A Female Octopus Eats Off Her Own Tentacles One by One, or How to Eat Yourself Alive, a one-woman narrative in two acts. Act one, he is like a word that you cannot remember, so close to being recalled yet always escaping. He is filed under things that I will never have, white skin, an A in calculus, the wild boy, with his chestnut-colored hands and clean fingernails, hands that create, hands that work hard, dreamboat boy with his white teeth and small pink mouth that does not say mean things anymore, well, as much as it used to, although I will never fix my lips to say I need him, never feel like half a girl when he is gone. There's an imprint of his laugh somewhere on my skin, a space that dwindles in my smile, just small enough for him to fit. Act two. It is true what they say about girls in love. He often tells me what he thinks of me, and then I think that of myself. His brown boy voice says that it loves me, and then suddenly I love Lucille again too. His hands reach out as if they need me, and then this freckled skin remembers it has a purpose plot twist. Paintbrush boy says that he doesn't want me anymore, plot twist. I spread lavender oil on the sheets before he comes over, plot twist. I lay on his bed all afternoon and listen to the irony in his words as he tells me how much he hates feeling used, plot twist. I let him choose any orifice he wants until I remember that pamphlet I read in my doctor's office about coping mechanisms. Plot twist. Somewhere, in the midst of it all, he half threatens, half jokes that he could choke me until I died if he wanted to. And so I do. Die, I mean. And as I am ascending out of my body, it feels as if I am looking down at myself from above. Looking down from a place that is neither heaven, nor hell, nor the ceiling. Plot twist. Brown boy says that he doesn't believe in heaven, only believes in stars. And then, as if for his amusement, as if on the cue of amen, I transform into a twinkle in a galaxy that only shines for him, just a nightlight in his dark hands. Thank you. And the next poem is called Day 47, because I wrote it on the 47th day of 2017. And it deals with one of those topics that one of the girls is speaking about. And on the 47th day of the 17th year, I find myself back in the exact same spot I was in 2016. It is day 47 and I am back, standing in front of the medicine cabinet. It is day 47 and I pulled out a strand of my hair yesterday, just one, to remember what the pain felt like, just one. But I guess that could still count as a relapse, right? It is day 47 and my body is sore, sore from the gym, sore from the positions I've been sleeping in, sore from the way he had me bent over the bed sheets. I can't believe I shaved my legs for that. It is day 47, and he tells me not to fall in love with him, says he probably won't fall in love with me, and I don't know why I am so upset, because on day 35, that is exactly what I thought I wanted. It is day 47, and I am in the school library. A group of boys sit behind me trying to guess how many dudes this girl they know has slept with. One boy estimates a whopping 55. Before they get up and leave, one boy says to the other, "Hey, don't worry about it, man. You know these sluts, that they always get what they deserve in the end. It is day 47, and a tall, dark-skinned boy says that I would make a good housewife. It is day 46, and a short, brown-skinned boy says that I do have a voice like a white girl, that he can tell I'm from the northwest side, but that my voice sounds so smooth that it probably feels great when I deep throat, and I think about how this is a rude thing to say. I think about how he will never find out how lately, every time I find myself on my knees, God must see it as an opportunity to kick me right back onto my ass. It is day 47, and I think about how I was going to be abstinent for the whole year. Think about how I used to have a purity ring. And it is on day 47 that a girl who is prettier than me, but who I have never met before, asked me why I slept with her boyfriend. And I think about how I have never had one of those, a boyfriend. It is day 47, and I try to explain to my best friend that it's not like I'm a nymphomaniac or something. I just get lonely. That sometimes I have so many empty spaces inside, I let the boys fill up whichever one they say they can. It is day 47, and I think about how I'm supposed to make it through 318 more days of this. But I guess that this is karma. I mean, you know what they say about these sluts, right? How we always get what we deserve in the end. Thank you. So this next poem is called Bedmaking, alternatively titled Smith Family Monologue. Why does this happen every day, Langley? Why do I come home every evening to a house that is not clean, to a kitchen that has not been cooked in? I am just trying to help you, Langley. Help you become a better person, a better wife. Let me see your hands, Langley. Did you wash them? You can't clean anything with dirty fingernails. Why are your hands always so dirty, dirty, just like your room? Dirty just like your search history, dirty just like your mind. Your mind is so dirty, always with the liberal stuff, always with the free love stuff, never with the Christian stuff that I taught you, always questioning me and how I raised you. I raised you right. You're gonna go to Northwestern because I raised you correctly, raised you perfectly. I didn't raise you like this, Langley. I don't even know who you are anymore. You're just a brown girl that lives in my house and eats all my food and never keeps her room clean. Langley, take out the trash. And by trash, I mean the way that you think. I mean all this shit you're always spewing. Langley, clean up your act or your room. I don't care which one, just pick, because I can't have you walking around here like I didn't raise you correctly. You're gonna go to Northwestern, Langley, make all of my sisters from the backcountry proud. Aren't you glad I moved you to the city from here? From the south, from the old country. If you had stayed there, you might have been a mom by now. Aren't you glad you're not a mom, Langley? Aren't you glad you're not pregnant, Langley? When I was pregnant with you, they told me to get an abortion. They said that I was too old. They told me that my skin was not capable of stretching over another little body, but I didn't get an abortion. I had you, and I raised you, and I raised you correctly, correctly, and with clean hands, and this is the things that I get. You disappoint me, Langley, because you don't know how to spell, and you don't keep your room clean enough. No, you don't actually disappoint me. But I know that's what you think, and I won't bother to correct you because I hope that it motivates you. I know how much the fear of failure and the belief that you might grow up to become nothing keeps you up at night. I have heard you sleepwalking downstairs at 3 a.m. I have sensed you in the bathroom, sifting around the drawers, hopefully not looking for what I think you are looking for, the same thing that your cousin from the south, from the back country was looking for. Langley, don't be like your cousin from the back country. Because when she did it, we had to spend all night scrubbing the smell of blood from the linoleum. But did you know that she got into Northwestern. Have you talked to her lately? Langley, I love you. It's just that I want you to have a good plan. A plan for Northwestern. A plan to make me proud. Langley, go wash your hands. Dinner's almost ready. Thanks. So I have one more poem. I think as citizens of Canton, we all know there's been a lot of death in these past few weeks, especially. I remember my first encounter with that sort of as a high school student was when a fellow student at our school had committed suicide. I think we were freshmen. So this is a poem that I wrote, I think, a year after that. So it's relatively old. It's titled, A Young Girl Wraps Her Head Around Death. Recently, I have succumbed to the pressure of reviewing life more as a series of analogies and a lot less like the abstract concept that it is. For example, I have recently discovered that life is like a maze that I thought I'd grown familiar with. Or life is like a map that I was under the impression I knew like the back of my hand, only to find out I've been reading it upside down like the entire time. And life, like most good things, can be neatly compressed into a wholesome sports reference, i.e., life is a lot like middle school soccer or little league baseball because my mom signed me up for it and expected me to be like really good or something, except that sports just aren't my thing. Except now it's too late, because your mom already bought all the equipment and your dad paid the entry fee like 2 weeks ago and drove you and all your friends to practice that afternoon, so you don't really have a choice. Except one day you come to practice and find out that girl you never really bothered to talk to quit the team. And I use the word quit as one of those euphemisms I mentioned earlier. Yes, there is a choice. But I would not call the people who quit the team quitters. I would just call them tired. I would not call them cowards. I would call them preemptive. The only ones in the world brave enough to grab a flashlight and see what's on the other side before the sun rises or the fluorescent lights flick back on. No, I would not call them selfish. But I would call them by so many other names. I would call them Sandra Bland, if indeed that is what happened. I would call them myself with my old habit of whole medicine cabinets. I would call them Tyler because he did not see our sophomore year. All the people I know who have committed suicide have done it in the summer. And I still can't crack the code on that. All I've got so far is theory. That being a summertime ghost floating 100 feet over your whole neighborhood as it smells like grass and looks like light and sounds like kids laughing must be the most beautiful thing in the world. And I wonder if as they ascend out of their bodies, which are probably lying on the bathroom floor or somewhere else where their mothers will have to find them, if they think about the neighborhood kids, if just for a moment, when they are hovering over the playground or the pool at the end of the block, do they think about the summers when they used to laugh that loudly, when the only thing between them and God was the blue sky and the hot air? Or do they just pause in the clouds over the driveway, reflecting on being the only ones brave enough to grab a flashlight and reminiscing about the summers when all of their friends used to carpool to the games on the afternoons when they played Little League. Thank you.